Good evening. Welcome back to worship. As we gather on this Good Friday, at sunset, as the darkness falls across the land, and our eyes are turned towards the cross of Jesus, certainly his betrayal, but the suffering he endured, but it's out of great love that we gather tonight, Jesus' love and our love for one another. This Good Friday service points us towards Easter Sunday. I'd like to welcome you back on Easter Sunday. We'll start our broadcast at 6:30, again at 8, and then 10:30. Again, we'll be having communion, Holy Communion, celebrated during our worship service. So I invite you to consider adding your own elements, finding a simple bread, some wine or grape juice, so that you, in your own community, in your own place of worship, can join together and share this sacrament that Jesus has given to us as a gift of forgiveness and hope and resurrection promise. Again, looking forward to having you join us on Easter Sunday. We begin our Good Friday service.
Took the blame to see my name written in the wounds, for through your suffering I am free. Death is crushed to death, life is mine to live.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. He did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for us all. Christ suffered for our sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. Here is the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We shrink before pain and suffering, O Lord. We feel the impact of evil as we speak of Good Friday. Open our hearts. Open our understanding. May we reach beyond the suffering to the coming resurrection. Amen.
Reading from Luke 23:32-38. Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews."
Listen to them. They jeer at him. They taunt him. Don't they know who he is? I was once a leper. There were 10 of us that day walking along the road. We heard Jesus and his disciples approaching, and we began to shout, "Unclean! Unclean!" as we had been instructed to do. We didn't dare let anyone come near for fear they would get this dreaded disease. But I couldn't help crying out as he came close to us, "Jesus, Master, have mercy!" And he did. If only they had given him a chance, he could give them new life as he gave me new life. He healed our disease, but he also forgave our sins. Even though I was healed and forgiven, I find it amazing that he could forgive his own killers. But he did.
A reading from Luke 23:39-43. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
Today you will be with me, my child, in paradise so fine. Take heart and pray, may faith be yours until we cross.
Look at us. Was that robbery worth this? No. If only I could live my life over. Don't sneer. You're no better. We deserve what we're getting. But look at him. Anyone can see he's different. He's no criminal. Go on. Make fun if you want to. But I, for one, don't believe he should be here. Lord Jesus, I don't understand why you're here. You've done no wrong. Please, Jesus, I've not lived a very good life, but would you remember me when you get to your kingdom? I don't know where that is, but I want the peace that surrounds you. And Jesus answered me, "Today, you will be with me in paradise."
A reading from John 19:25-27. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home.
He called me John, the beloved disciple. We all walked the journey with Jesus and knew how much he loved his mother. That close intimacy of a mother and son, which allows for teasing and joking and understanding in difficult times. I remember the wedding feast. Just a short time after his wilderness experience, the groom's family had misjudged the number of folks, and their pockets were not full of unspent coins. But Mary, in her usual caring way, simply told the servants to do whatever Jesus told them to do. Jesus was surprised. But would you never do or say anything to cause her any shame? She understood his comment much later about everyone who does the Father's will being his mother and brothers and sisters. The brothers were angry, but she knew he must be about his Father's business. She has been as close to me as my own mother. Of course, I will take her. And of course, I will love her and care for her just as Jesus would have done. At least as far as God gives me the strength to do.
A reading from Matthew 27:45-49. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "This man is calling for Elijah." At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
Savior bows his head and cries, "My God, forsake me not. Why hast thou turned away?"
I thought I knew what utter loneliness was. I was rejected by men and women alike. Oh, the men used me and the women laughed behind my back. But I was so lonely until Jesus came into my life. I don't understand. God loved me through Jesus. He healed so many people through Jesus. We, some of us anyway, believe Jesus was the Messiah, the chosen one, the Son of God. So why did God turn his back in this most trying time of his life? Was God testing him or allowing the evil one to test him like Job? Was it too painful for even God to watch his only begotten son die so horribly? The prophet Isaiah once said, "For a brief moment I abandoned you, but with great compassion I will gather you. In overflowing wrath for a moment I hid my face from you, but with everlasting love I will have compassion on you." Is it possible he was prophesying about this day?
A reading from John 19, 28 and 29. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth.
"I thirst," he cries out from the tree, and soldiers standing there hasten to raise the sponge to his lip as death draws in.
Another time I heard him whisper those awful words of suffering. It was a hot day, about noon. The sun bore down on us like we were food in an oven. He sat at the edge of the well. No one else was near. He had nothing with which to draw water. Sweat dripped from his brow. As I drew a bucket of water from the well, he said, "I thirst. Give me a drink." He looked so sad. I wonder if he knew about this awful day. He told me he would give living water if I only wanted it. Of course I wanted it. I wouldn't have to ever go out in the heat of the day again to draw water. But that isn't what he meant. He soon made it clear the living water comes from within the Spirit. I wonder if he's thinking of that living water now. Is that what he's thirsting for?
A reading from John, chapter 19, verse 30. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Yes, it is finished. What began so long ago in a little stable in Bethlehem has come to fulfillment. The angels sang that night from a star-filled sky. They led shepherds to come and worship. Starlight filled the stable. Later, astronomers or kings came to visit. They brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. What would they think if they could see him now? The sun should be shining, but it's brighter, darker than midnight. No stars, no moon, no angel's song of hallelujah. I can almost hear a song of mourning. His work is finished, at least for now. As painful as it is to watch him suffer and know that I will not see him again, I somehow feel that we have not seen the end of my son. One part of his work is done. But the greater part of redemption is yet to come.
A reading from Luke 23:44-49. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 PM, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance watching these things.
Father, I commit my life to you.
I always wanted to be a soldier for my emperor. As a small boy, I dreamed of battles where I would save the country from barbarians who would take over the land. When the opportunity came for me to actually be a soldier, I was overjoyed. I worked hard and moved up the ranks. I still dreamed of saving my country, but my dream began to fade. The first time I had to stand guard for an execution, watching helpless men being crucified for their crimes caused my stomach to turn. I could accept it only because they were criminals who deserved to be punished. Now, once again, doubts fill my mind. This man was innocent. He committed no crime. So why the cruel fate of the tree? And beyond that, surely, this man was the Son of God. What have we done? What have I done? As Good Friday comes to a close, Easter is only a day away. Go in peace, remembering the suffering, looking ahead to the joy, in the name of the risen Christ. May God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit grant you peace both now and forever. Amen. Amen.
See you.